I've basically started off from a clean slate. So I've uninstalled the LiveScribe Plus app from my mobile device. I've unpaired the pen. So everything is like a clean slate at the moment. So let me just throw my mobile on the screen here for you guys to see. All right. So I've installed the LiveScribe app. Here we go. All right, so you launch the app, and as soon as you launch, you'll get prompted to pair a pen that you might have, and also, of course, communication is done via Bluetooth, so you need to give permissions to the app to do that as well. Then you can either pair your pen through either your Symphony or your Eiger pen or your Smart Pen 3, or you can enter without a Smart Pen if you just want to look at your documentation. So I will go and so one thing to mention as well. So with the Symphony Pen, actually let's start there. So you guys wanted to know the differences between the Symphony and the Eiger. So I don't know if you've had a chance to visit the LiveScribe support knowledge base site yet. There's a lot of useful information on there and knowledge and documentation that you will help if ever you get stuck with anything. So let me just bring that up quickly. So here we basically compare the our old Echo One pen, our new Eiger, and then our latest Symphony pen, and this basically writes down the differences between each of them. I mean, the main differences between the Symphony and Eiger, there isn't really any. I mean, the Symphony pen is just a lot better on battery management, battery power consumption, basically. And that is because it has an on-off sensor in the pen cap that basically, when the pen cap is on the pen is turned off and put into a power-saving state. Once you remove the cap, the pen is automatically turned on and then connected to the pair device. So that's how you get this difference here of 45 days standby time versus the Eiger's 10 days. And you can see also here the power button. There's no power button on the Eiger, but on the Symphony, you have the pen cap that performs that function. In terms of memory, they're all very similar. So that's kind of the and of course the Symphony pen is about 3 grams heavier than the Eiger because of these extra sensors in the pen cap and in the front of the pen. So that's the kind of differences from a hardware perspective. On a software perspective, from the application point of view, there's no difference whatsoever. Both these pens will be dealt with in exactly the same way. So we kind of keep that the same and keep it familiar, so people don't have to learn new ways of doing things with new pen models. A few other things that was also quite interesting on the site here. I mean, there's lots of knowledge base articles here you can view. Here's user guides for the iOS application, for the Android application. If you click on these, you will come to this screen. You can download the PDFs here. And that'll basically provide you with a one-stop shop for any questions you might have regarding those. Right, so coming back. Okay. So we get back. So you launch the app. I'll remove the pen cap. So basically, because this pen is not paired to any mobile device at the moment, it will basically, as soon as you remove the pen cap, it will start broadcasting itself as a Bluetooth discoverable device. And lucky with the iOS, they just kind of pick up these things and kind of make it intuitive and just very easy to use. So removing the pen cap, you'll see I'll automatically get a prompt if I want to pair this pen. So I'll say yes, I'll go ahead and pair. And then the LED on the pen will change from green. So also, usually in your LiveScribe books, let me just grab one here. Usually when you open these books, on the first page, you will see sorry, you can't really see now, a device pairing action area there. So you just click your pen in that, and that'll put your pen into a Bluetooth discoverable state. Or if you don't have access to that, just keep your finger pressed on the pen tip for a few seconds. And then the pen will go into a Bluetooth discoverable state as well. And you'll see it start flashing blue. So basically, as you go through the app for the first time, you will be taken through this wizard that'll basically give you a few pointers and directions about how to get the pen paired. So I'll just do that again. Okay, here we go. So again, the first screens, you'll get your tutorial. It'll just give you a breakdown of the app, how it's used. You can go through that. You can exit it and can access the tutorial at any time again via the settings. LiveScribe will select to send you notifications, another permission you can allow. And then you have that. So if I go into the side menu, you can set your transcription language as well. There's quite a few languages in there that it can recognize and transcribe. So I'll just keep mine there. All right, and I'll pair this pen. And you heard that little beep? That was confirmation. So now it's Bluetooth connected. As soon as it's connected, you'll get your registration screen where you can just fill out your details and get your pen registered with LiveScribe. This way, we can just keep track of pens and ownership and traceability and send out tailored communications to our active users. And also, if there's new firmware versions for the pens mm-hmm. available, this will assist with that as well. So I'll just skip this for now. All right, so we launched the app. Your pen's connected now, and now it's busy syncing. And it's pulling off all the data from this pen into the application. So the first screen you will see here, it'll give you a breakdown of all the notebooks that it's synced and all the pages of that notebook that's been written on. You can click on a notebook and go look at the individual pages in there. This will basically bring that up. You can zoom in, zoom out. Okay, so here you get a breakdown of your notebooks in a list view. You can select any of them and it will take you to that notebook. Below that is feeds. So potentially you could have, this pen can be paired to four different devices. However, whenever there's an Apple device in the mix, all bets are off. Apple is basically very notorious for hogging Bluetooth connections, even from devices that it's not paired to anymore. So if you have maybe two or three different Android devices, that'll work seamlessly between all of them. You just open up and connect and it will connect to that device. But if you have maybe an Android and an iOS device and you're working on your iOS device and you want to go to your Android device, you have to go into your iOS Bluetooth settings, forget the pen, and maybe just turn Bluetooth off just to be on the safe side. Get it paired to your Android device and then use it on there. And then you can turn Bluetooth on again on your iOS. So that just brings me to this feed screen. Let me just get another pen in here. So basically, you could have an Ager pen, you could have a Symphony pen, and you can have a LiveScribe 3 pen. All three of those pens could be connected to this iOS mobile device at some point in time. Not necessarily connected at this point in time, but it will keep the feeds of each pen for you to choose here. So I'm just going to maybe put my LiveScribe pen as well. Okay, so again, I've turned on my LS3 pen. It's gone into a Bluetooth discoverable state, and the device just picked it up, asked me to pair. I say yes. Now there should be a lot more information on this pen. So you'll see it's busy syncing now, and your UI will just get populated as it goes. Here you go at the bottom, all the new notebooks that's coming in, and you'll see this little pen icon here at the top will show you that it's busy in a syncing state. It's advisable not to do anything with the app or the pen whilst the syncing is taking place, just to ensure everything is synced correctly to the device. So we'll just wait for it to complete. Once it completes, these little arrows will be removed from the icon. Here at the bottom, you'll see there's a little notebook here with a little file thing on it. That basically is an indication that this notebook has been archived. This basically means that all the text on this notebook here at the bottom, that can't be changed anymore. That whole notebook and all the associated text has been archived for later use. And that is because when you buy LiveScribe notebooks, so this is the Notebook 4. The dot pattern in all Notebook 4 books are the same. So if you were to complete this Notebook 4 and you'll take another Notebook 4 and start writing in that, it will just sync the strokes to the same notebook in here. So that is where you will, once you finish the notebook, you will archive that notebook here at the bottom. Take your new notebook 4 and start writing in it, and it will create a new notebook 4 up here in the active list. Okay, but as you can see, that's still syncing. So I'll just carry on. So now here at the on the side menu, you'll see two pens there. It's my glossy pen, my LiveScribe 3, and my Symphony pen. And now I can just maybe, if I know there's a note I'm looking for that I wrote with my Symphony pen, I'll just go and click on the Symphony, and it will basically bring up all the feeds that was written with this pen. And here I can just go and look through them, find the one I want, and then so also here from the feed screen I can just quickly jump in. Oh no, it's still syncing. I'll talk about that later. Okay, so that is to get feeds for your different pens. You can do that via the feeds section there. Pencasts, you guys, I don't know if you're familiar with that or not, but that's basically I don't know if you're familiar with our previous Echo Pen. The Echo Pen used to have a microphone within the pen that you could record audio with whilst writing with it. The Symphony, the A Gear, the Smart Pen 3, all these pens do not have mics on them or speakers. So basically, what you do is you will record the audio through your mobile device and you can still write with your pen. And then at the end, when you stop the recording, it will basically form what we call a pencast. And that will basically combine all your written text with the audio. I'll do a little demonstration of that later on to show you exactly what that does. But you can basically go and listen to your pencasts. And as you listen to the pencast, you will see on screen that the text is getting filled in at the time, you know, what you were writing at the time of what was said, you will see on screen. And so those are pencasts. Collections. Also in the LiveScribe notebooks, you'll see on some pages or in some paper products of ours that they've got a little a star icon and a flag icon and a little tag icon at the bottom of each page. This is basically what we call collections. And if you would like to star or flag or label something you are writing, what you'll do is you will click on this, tick the star or the flag or the label, whichever you want, and start writing. As soon as those strokes get synced to the mobile application, they will be tagged with a star or a flag or a label. And that will be then seen within your collection section. Again, I'll give you a little demonstration of that later on. Just a quick one here, app settings. So here you have your transcription language that you can choose from. At the moment, I've got English, but here are all the languages that you have access to. And if there's an update available, you can just update that from here and it will download that. So while that's going, I'll carry on. Reminders. Again, LiveScribe Plus would like to have access to your to reminders. So you can, it'll basically go to your device and into your reminders app and see what you have in there, and you can basically just add on to that. Or when you write, you can just send it to the relevant reminder if you have a shopping list or something like that. Again, audio recording, you can set low, medium, or high. This it's up to you and space, but just be aware that if you go for high, it will be it will use more space on your device for high quality recording. Cloud services. These are the guys we are currently integrated with: Dropbox, Evernote, Google Drive, and OneNote. So Dropbox, for instance, I just clicked it. It opens the Dropbox app on my mobile device, and it says LiveScribe wants access. So I'll allow that. And there you go. And then you can choose how it gets synced to Dropbox. Are you going to make PDFs of your files and sync it to Dropbox, or do you want just PNG files, or do you just want plain text TXT files? The history will give you a breakdown of what has been sent to Dropbox, and you can do this for all of them. All right, and there's OneNote hooked up. So let's just keep it to those two for now. So cloud services and then Quicksend. Also on our paper products, sorry, I don't know if you guys will be able to see, but here at the top, these are your three shortcut keys. And basically, when you tick one, it will basically perform the function that you program in here for shortcut one. So like when you tick one, do you want it to be sent to Dropbox or to OneNote? So let's say I want it to send to OneNote and I want PDFs. So shortcut one has now been programmed. And then of course, as well here, you'll have access to the LiveScribe support knowledge base, a few articles there. And if you want to send a direct message to support as well about an issue you may have, you can do that from within the app as well. Again, here you can access the tutorial again. And that's about the highlights from settings. Okay, so let's get back. I'm going to turn my glossy off. So you'll see that become disconnected. I'll turn my Symphony on again. There we go, because I did unpair it before. So it's just going to ask me to pair again. And connect it. Good. All right. So coming back to the notebooks view quickly. Also from here, you can if you long press on the notebook, let's do long press there, you will have some options that pop up. Ooh. Let me and you'll be able to rename the notebook to something more logical. You can archive this notebook, you can delete the notebook, or you can share the notebook. Now, if you select share, you can email it, you can print it, Dropbox, OneNote. You can send it to one of those cloud services, or you can select to auto send it. Now, auto send, what that does. So let's say I want to auto send that notebook to OneNote, to Black's Notebooks. And you'll see it get a little icon on there now. So what that means now is now every time when I write on that notebook, the synced handwriting text will just get automatically sent to OneNote. So as I'm writing, you'll see that new page appear with my text just being displayed. All right. So as you can see, that's a text I just wrote. Get out of there. And because it's synced, I mean, sometimes, of course, it could take a little while to sync to these other services. So we just have to give it a bit of time, but it will get there. So here we go. This is it. That's just been synced to OneNote. So of course, from here you have your PDF that you can download. And this will open it up here for you to view as well. All right, so that's the auto send. You guys know the send now as well. Just manually sending one page or whole notebooks at a time. Yeah, so whilst this is connecting, I mean, so that's basically the gist of the technology. You know, you write in your notebooks, it gets synced to your mobile device. One thing I want to just show you guys as well quickly is the transcription.
Frederick, whilst you're doing that, there's a question being asked about the audio format for.
Sorry, it's MP3. All right, so just quickly here. So the transcription. So if you go into the feeds menu, just again here, I'll go to feeds, and this will bring up all the feeds I've written with a pen. So if I long press one of them, you'll get some dynamic menu items popping up there. You can copy it, you can edit it, you can assign tags to it. Clicking right, so you can create reminders, you can open it in reminders, and you can share it as well. But if you were to swipe left, that will bring up a delete thing if you want to delete it. And if you swipe left, that'll basically flip it over and show you the transcribed text that it thought you have written. In this case, it's pretty spot on. Oops. Flip right and it will bring it back to your handwriting. Next one as well. And of course, once you've transcribed it, you can share your transcriptions as well. Just by long pressing on the relevant feed line as well. So that's the mobile side of life. Then we've also got the LiveScribe Plus desktop application. And this is basically the same as the mobile application. If you're comfortable editing your stuff on PC more than on mobile, then you'll be able to use this application to do that. Again, you'll just connect your pen via USB. Let's just do that quick. And it'll basically sync all the things from it in here for you to use. So again, you can go in, you can look at things, and yeah. So that's the PC side of things. This is available on Windows and Mac, and it's also accessible from the LiveScribe website. So if I go here, I'll go to Resources, LiveScribe Plus. Just scroll down. Yeah, you can get your Android, iOS, and then here you have your Windows and Mac OS. And now that it's disconnected from USB, it's automatically gone into Bluetooth mode. And because I didn't, so you're going to get this screen every time if you do not register your pen. Once your pen's registered, you won't ever see the screen again. So it is advisable to register your pens just to avoid that little headache. Okay, so I'm going to take a book. And then basically from within the application, you'll see that little recording icon bottom right. So I'm gonna click that. And then of course it would like to access my microphone on my mobile device. So I'll allow that. And you can see the recording has now started. Ooh. So now that the pen cast is recording, you'll also see on your pen, that there's a solid red LED. So whilst maybe you're in a lecture hall and the professor is talking and you're taking notes at the same time, and then taking notes for my Pencast. Okay, I'm going to stop my recording. And it's basically going to create that Pencast for me, which is my audio along with my strokes. So now I can go in here, I can go into my Pencasts. You'll see that's there. So I'll bring that up. And you'll see that the Pencast is indicated on the UI through green text. So whenever you see green in your UI, you can know that there is audio associated with this text. So here at the bottom, I'll just click play. Sorry, so just jumping in here quickly. So you'll see all the text has now turned to gray. So that basically indicates that strokes are about to happen. And there you see the gray gets replaced by green as it coordinates with the audio and the written text. Okay, and that was that. And then also from here, you'll be able to share. You can email that, print that, save it as a video locally on, or yeah, sync it to Dropbox, OneNote. So that was basically Pencasts. Yeah, I think that's basically the gist of it. So I hope I covered everything coherently. But if you have any questions, please feel free. Let's have a look at the chat quickly.
One of the questions, Frederick, which I couldn't hear either, was the recording you made as you was writing, it didn't come through over Zoom. Is that because it's just...
Yeah, sorry. It was loud and clear in my headphones. Right. Sorry.
And the other question was, the last question prior to that was, is it possible to transcribe on desktop application?
Yeah, it was one of the things we found in an earlier version, Frederick. I think the one you're running is a, to be fair, slightly newer version. But when it was one of the earliest versions of the desktop application, when we were doing a little bit of training with our trainers last year, we weren't able to figure out whether it was possible to transcribe with the desktop apps. So although that's maybe a nice to have feature.
I actually see it's already in here. So just looking at the feeds, this is the one I just wrote. Yeah. Here's your text on the side.
Ah, fantastic.
When you go into the feeds and you click on here, you can basically get here, click transform, and it will give you the transcribed text that you can edit if it's incorrect.
Ah, yeah.
Yeah. So that's all possible.
That's good. I think that wasn't a feature in the earlier version. Maybe we're struggling to find it at the time.
No, it wasn't there. You're right.
Very, very helpful. Thank you for pointing that out. Dean is saying, who would be a typical user for this product? And I suppose a bit of a kind of a use case. It might be that we've got assessors who might want to chip in and answer that one as far as where you see LiveScribe fitting into recommendations. But generally, Dean, I think if we can sort of answer that a little bit more around students who maybe struggle multitasking around their note-taking strategies. And obviously, I think we've all probably been in a scenario where if you've made a recording of a lecture and then, you know, it could be an hour, 2 hours long, trying to find the bits of detail that you really need to draw out afterwards. So it might be it might just be a 10-minute segment of a lecture that you miss, where possibly the content was something that you need to review to kind of brush up on your understanding, because you've got something that is syncing well with your notes, and you've got a visual cue to be able to find those gaps within your notes and then kind of play back the relevant audio, rather than just having a, you know, 2 hour long chunk of audio that you find really, really difficult to navigate. So for me, having been a trainer previously, that's where I kind of found the main benefit of LiveScribe. But obviously, when you think of the organization side of things, being able to look at study strategies for students in terms of how they organize their notes, you could have all your different lectures, all your different modules, folded within your LiveScribe. You know, when the pen fills up, you can get them archiving their notes into relevant blocks so that they're easy to find. Most digital recorders, it can be a bit difficult to folder things. But I think just to have your visual notes and your audio recordings in one place is a great strategy. Natasha just saying it can be good for engineering and architecture students. students who need to draw a lot of diagrams. So yeah, it's a really good point there, because we know LiveScribe does quite a good job of kind of straightening up lines and things if you're drawing things like graphs, etc., shapes and so on. Okay.
So I mean the usual use case that this technology works great with is with students in lecture halls, because basically they'll take notes, they'll just hit record, and it will record the lecturer giving his lesson. So at the moment, I'm just showing my pencast here again. Now, usually for students, they'll have pages and pages of green text as they've recorded and taken notes. And I just want to show. So basically, when they do revision and they go through their notes, and they come across a topic that they want more information on or want to know what the lecturer said at that point in time, because that's what they need to know. So I just wanted to point this out quickly. So you'll see at the moment, this is my pencast. I'm just going to kill it, get back to it. Okay. So it's zero. I've gone through my notes. I know here on my is the piece of audio that I need to start listening from. So I can just go and click with my finger on the word my, and it will start the audio from that point in time. So you can just catch up again on that. So that's quite handy as well.
We've got from Joe there. Do you need to be near the speaker to audio record on your phone?
But yeah, I mean, the sound needs to be close to your phone. So if you're doing it remotely, I mean, ideally your phone should be next to your speaker potentially.
Thanks very much, Frederick, for that. I think one point worth mentioning is that because if we're using the mobile phone apps, we have in the past supplied some of the accessories for LiveScribe, including the 3D recording headset, which is gives you the little microphones in the ear tips. So it's a LiveScribe accessory. We did used to supply that headset on occasion for the previous LiveScribe pens. I'm not sure if you could tell us whether that works as an accessory, or whether we could use other microphones with the mobile device as well, like a condenser microphone, a directional microphone.
Yeah, sorry, Mum, I'm going to forget to get those answers for you.
Yeah.
Another bit of feedback on that one, on the pen. A lot of people have said to me, and I'm probably guilty of it myself, actually, because we do so much typing on a keyboard, people have noticed the quality of the handwriting has got worse. So when they're actually writing information down that they need to share with people by using this pen, because obviously they can transcribe it into kind of text at some point, they find that side of useful.
Yeah.
So basically the quality of the handwriting. But anything where people want to do a lot of writing, and if they draw doodle as well as part of that, whatever profession or kind of situation they're in, by recording it electronically, it just makes it so much easier to be able to share that information.
Yeah, I think it's almost like the digital organization as well, isn't it?
Yes.
And it's a really kind of key thing with that. I know I'm certainly guilty of struggling to find things in the various notebooks where I've got notes and lists of things to do. Probably digitally they're much easier to find if they're labeled and dated, and you can think back to what you were doing at the time.
Yeah.
So it's certainly an advantage from an organization and then kind of compartmentalizing all your different categories of notes and make them much, much easier to navigate.
Yeah.
I think that covers all most of the questions.
There was a question about
background noise.
The background and also the maths question, which I think is a no to the answer. Equations.
Yeah, yeah. So I mean that is all dependent on the handwriting recognition engine being used, and we are totally at the mercy of them. I know that MyScript is bringing out improved handwriting recognition engines for specifically for math as well. So of course, once that's available, we'll definitely be upgrading our apps to be utilizing that as well.
Fantastic. I've just got a couple of questions I have actually missed. Cost difference between the Ageas Smart Pen and the Symphony Pen. I'll be able to get our costs over to you in terms of what we were quoting previously for Ageas versus Symphony. Obviously, Symphony is the higher price pen, isn't it, Frederick?
Yeah. Yes.
But I don't believe the cost difference is significant looking at the comparison that you gave. I think our cost difference is under £20 retail. Very good. Well, just to say thanks. Thanks to yourself, Frederick, and for Mark for coordinating the training on behalf of us at Barry Bennett. We really appreciate your input. And
thank you.
I'm sure everybody on the call has found it useful in terms of our Barry Bennett staff, but also for our external customers that are on the call, and from the higher education institutions and from the assessment centres, we've got a mix of people from different professions. So thanks very much to everyone. I hope you found the webinar this afternoon useful. If you've got any further questions or queries in regards to Barry Bennett in terms of what we're doing, please check out our website. And the information on there is changing from day to day or week to week in regards to what we're able to offer at this time as far as appointments. So if you've got any questions on that. But thanks again. Have a lovely rest of your day and speak soon.